everyone. In today's session, let us discuss about some more adaptations what the organisms will show to combat with the situations. In the previous lecture, we discussed about the adaptations which are purely covered in NCERT. Let us discuss some more examples to make the topic even understanding. Okay, so we'll start with adaptations part 2 today. Now, we will discuss water-related adaptations today. So, water-related adaptations, we'll see. We'll see what are the adaptations of freshwater organisms we can see, of marine water organisms we can see, and brackish water organisms we can see. We will start with, so what are the adaptations shown by freshwater organisms? Adaptations shown by freshwater organisms, or adaptations shown in freshwater. Now, if you have to see the adaptation seen in freshwater, what the organisms will do, right? So, we have to discuss, if you take the salt concentration in the freshwater, in inland water, the salt concentration we have already discussed, it will be 0 to 5%. And the organisms which are in inland water, for example, take a fish. So, we will take a fish for an example, right? So, inside the fish, the salt concentration, something around, we will take around 15%. Now, the water concentration in which it is habitat, it is 5% because it's a freshwater body, and the organism, it is 15%. That means the osmotic pressure is low here, and the osmotic pressure is high here. Because of this factor, what happens? Water starts moving. Salt concentration more means water salt concentration less means water concentration is more here. Salt concentration is more means water concentration is less here. So OP low means water concentration high. Osmotic pressure low, salt concentration is 5% means water concentration will be high. And here, because the solute concentration is low, the solute concentration is high, the water concentration will be low. Solid concentration is more, so the water concentration is low. Then the water, we know, what is osmosis? Movement of water from high water potential to low water potential. Here the water concentration is more, here the water concentration is less. Then the water starts going from the freshwater body into the animal. When the water starts growing, going from the freshwater into the animal, what is this called? Endosmosis. It is called endosmosis. Now, what are the adaptations that the organisms show to tackle this endosmosis issues? We have to see. Okay. So, the first point, if we go, fresh water, if we go with freshwater protists like amoeba. Now, you know, the amoeba which is in freshwater, it has contractile vacuoles and axillary vacuoles to tackle the water-related issues. So, freshwater forms like, freshwater protists like amoeba, so they manage their excess water by having a contractile vacuole. Now, what this contractile vacuole will do? Whatever the excess water comes inside by endosmosis, now it will take the water and excretes the excess water. It excretes the excess water. So, this is one adaptation then exhibited by freshwater protozoan. Now, if we take a freshwater fish. Now, in freshwater fish, what adaptation it has? Now, it has glomerular kidneys. The first point we'll tell, it will have kidneys with large number of nephrons. Since the kidneys are glomerular type and it is having large number of nephrons, So then the glomerular filtration rate will be high. That means it excretes more urine. It excretes more urine and more diluted urine. You know, since the more water is coming inside, it has to eliminate that excess water. How does it eliminate that excess water? By developing glomerular kidneys, so which is having more number of nephrons. If the nephrons are more, glomerulus is more, then the filtration rate will be high. Then it filters more urine and the urine becomes diluted. So it will have a long, from here we can tell. So it will have a long glomerulus. And what does it excrete? It will excrete dilute urine. It will excrete dilute urine. Now, along with the urine, it will excrete little amount of salt also, which is there in the body. So, along with urine, it also excretes salt, right? So, since the salt is going out, in order to maintain the salt osmolarity, what it will do is, it has salt absorbing glands at the gills to take the salt which has lost. So, it also has salt absorbing chloride cells. Where? On the gills to take the salt what it has lost. Now, if these are the gills, on the gills we can tell, so these are the chloride cells. What are these? So these are the chloride cells which will absorb salts, which will absorb salts what it has lost. So these are two adaptations. So we started our class with water related adaptations and we are seeing the adaptations exhibited in fresh water. So, in fresh water, if you see, the salt concentration will be low. We studied that in inland water bodies, the salt concentration is 0 to 5. That's what I have taken. It is 5. And if you see the organism, in organism, solute concentration will be more only. Something like 10 or 15 in the solute concentration is there. Now, that means here the solute concentration is more. Solute concentration more means water concentration less. Here, salt concentration is 5% less. Water concentration will be more. Then because of more water here and less water inside, water goes into the body. The process is called endosmosis. How will the organisms tackle with this endosmosis issue? We have taken an example of a freshwater protist. Like amoeba, it will have contractile vacuole which takes all the excess water and it excretes the water. Now if you take a freshwater fish, like endosmosis happens inside. What are the adaptations it is showing? It will take a glomerular kidney, so which is long, and it has nephrons, more number of nephrons. So, because more number of nephrons are there and long glomerular kidneys are there, then the filtration rate will be high, then it will pass more urine and more diluted urine. Along with the urine, it eliminates few amounts of salts also. Since salt is going out to take the salt back in, so on the gills, it has salt absorbing chloride cells, which will take the salt inside back. So these are two examples. We will go with some more examples, right? If we see in summer, ponds and lakes, they dry up. Because of the heat content, they dry up. Then how the organism will cope up to those conditions where water is not there? Then we will talk about the third example. In summer, ponds and lakes dry up. Then how will the organisms cope up to such situations? Means, for example, if you take amoeba, to cope up to this dry situation, it will become spherical and it will make a spore wall or cyst wall, and it survives in that unfavorable conditions. It will slow down its metabolism. Now this is amoeba having pseudopodia. At the time of making cyst, it will lose the pseudopodia and it will merely become a spherical structure like this. And around the spherical structure, it will make a spore wall or cyst wall, which is a thick wall to tide over the unfavorable condition. So, it is making a cyst wall. The process of formation of cyst to tide over the unfavorable conditions is called encystation. So the amoeba, to tide over the dry conditions it is making, it's called encystation, right? This is one adaptation. Now if we go with sponges, proliferance in sponges. Now if you see sponges like this, they'll be there, right? So sponges, they have certain structures called gemmules to tide over unfavorable conditions. If you see one gemmule which is inside, so the structure of the gemmule will be like this. Now this gemmule, so this is a micropore and it contains, it holds many cells inside. These cells are called archisporial cells. And this is the wall. It has silicaceous spicules. Now what am I drawing here? These are spicules, right? So this is a gemmule which is present here. Proliferance, to tide over the dry conditions in the summer, they will make gemmules. And when the favorable conditions will turn up, now these archisporial cells will come outside, they'll break this, they'll come outside and they'll develop into a sponge again. So this is one more adaptation. Now another adaptation, if we take an African lungfish as an example. Now this African lungfish, how, what is adaptation it shows? So it goes for estivation in the summer. Protopterus is an example. Example of an African lungfish is Protopterus. So in order to avoid the peak summer, it will go for estivation. So it will burrow in the mud. It will burrow in the mud and it will even make a gelatinous cocoon around its body also. Make a gelatinous cocoon, right? So these are some adaptations we have seen. So for freshwater adaptations, we discussed the first point. What is that? Amoeba having contractile vacuole to lose the excess water. Second adaptation, what we have seen is the fish which is having glomerular kidneys and all, more number of nephrons and all, diluted urine and all. That's the second adaptation. Third adaptation, we were talking about in summer, when the ponds and lakes will dry up, then the amoeba which is present there, it will show encystation. It will make a spore wall. And it will slow down its metabolism. When the favorable conditions turn up, then the amoeba comes out. Then next one is proliferance in summer season to avoid the dryness. They make gemmules. This is the structure of a gemmule. It has a micropore. These are the archisporial cells and these are the spicules. When the favorable conditions turn, these archisporial cells come. They establish into a proliferant body again. Then next one is African lungfish, Protopterus if you see. Now to avoid the summer, it will go for estivation, and estivation means summer sleep. It is summer sleep. Now it burrows inside the mud. Not only burrowing inside the mud, it even makes a gelatinous cocoon around it. So these are freshwater adaptations. Now let us see the adaptations in marine water. If we have to discuss the adaptations in marine water, first of all, we should know the salt concentration in the marine water. So that's the first point. We started with freshwater also. We told in freshwater the salt concentration is 5%. Now in marine water, so adaptations in marine water. So if you recollect from the earlier lectures, we studied that the salt concentration in marine water will be, in sea water it will be. So we studied this, we told it's a neat exemplar question also. It is 30 to 35%. And if you take the fish or any animal which is there in the marine body, now the salt concentration certainly will not be 30 to 35. It will be lesser than that only. So I am taking the previous value 15 itself. Now here the salt concentration is more. If the salt concentration is more here, means water concentration is less. If the water concentration is less here, means the water concentration is more here. According to osmosis, we tell it's a movement of water from high water potential to low water potential. Here the water is more, here the water is less. So water comes out, ama? Water comes out. What is this called? This is called exosmosis. Now, how do these animals tolerate exosmosis? Now, we have to tell that. Now, these fishes, marine fishes, they have aglomerular kidneys. They will have aglomerular kidneys with less number of nephrons. Nephron is a functional unit of kidney, and if the nephrons are less, then the filtration rate will be less. If the filtration rate is less, the urine output will be less. If the urine output is less, mean to tell that it's a concentrated urine, means it is holding its water, right? So that dehydration will not happen in its body. So aglomerular kidneys it will have, less number of nephrons it will have, so the glomerular filtration rate will be is low. Then that means it will pass on concentrated urine. So to prevent dehydration of the body, it will pass on concentrated urine to prevent dehydration of the body. And another thing, it will drink water also. So it drinks excess water. These fishes will drink excess water. And what is there in the water? Salts are there in the water. Now, along with the water, salts also will come. Now, if that excess salt comes and it disturbs the salt metabolism in the fish, now, how is that salt eliminated out? So these fishes, they will have salt excreting chloride cells on the gills. So on the gills, they will have salt excreting chloride cells. So these are salt excreting chloride cells. And it has a aglomerular kidney and a short kidney, right? So let us make a short kidney only. And what does it pass? It pass concentrated urine. It will pass concentrated urine. So this is one adaptation we have seen, how the fish is coping up to the situation. Now, if we have to discuss another examples, some cartilaginous fishes. So they even retain urea and TMO, right, in their body fluids. So we can tell some cartilaginous fishes. Some cartilaginous fishes, they retain urea and TMO in the body fluids itself. Actually, urea should be excreted out. In order to maintain the salt concentration, osmomolar or isomolar, to the outside environment, it will retain little amount of urea and TMO in the body fluids, to keep isotonic to the external environment. Then the body fluid environment and the external environment will be isotonic if it holds on certain nitrogenous compounds like urea and TMO. This is another adaptation. Then another one, if you see some birds like penguins and seagulls, they have salt glands. So they have salt glands. The excess salt which is coming into the body, which droops down in the form of salt droplets through the nostrils. So seagulls and the penguins, they have salt glands which excrete salt solution which droops down. It droops down through how does it drops down through the nostrils, means the salt glands are present near the nostrils. If you take turtles, in turtles the salt glands are present near the eyes. So these are the adaptations of the organisms which are in fresh water. So what are the adaptations, in marine water? Now the adaptations of the organisms in marine water, if we have to quickly summarize, we are telling the sea water concentration, the salt concentration there is 30 to 35 parts per thousand ppt, we will tell. And in the animal body, it will be only lesser than that. Some as a numerical, I took 15%, just to tell it is lesser than that. Okay, that the salt concentration is more outside means water concentration is less outside. Inside, the salt concentration is less means water concentration is more. Now we know that water moves from high to low. That means water moves from outside to inside. Water is more here. Water is more here because the salt concentration is less here. So water moves outside. This is called exosmosis. To tackle the exosmosis related problems, they will have small kidneys. So they will have less glomerular filtration rate. They will have less number of nephrons. They concentrate the urine and thus they prevent dehydration. Another example, and they even drink more water. If they are drinking water, then they take salt also. Now that extra salt comes, that salt will disturb again the metabolism. So that extra salt will be excreted out by the salt excreting chloride cells which are present at the gills. Now if you take some cartilaginous fishes, they retain some solutes like urea and TMO in their body fluids so that inside outside the concentration of the solute will remain the same. Now if you take seagulls and penguins, they have salt glands and the salt glands keep dropping on the excess salts from the body. In seagulls and penguins, they are present at the nostrils. In turtles, the salt glands are present at the eyes. So in today's session, we discussed the first one, adaptations in the fresh water. Next one, adaptations in the seawater. Now we'll see the adaptations in brackish water, right? So the next point is adaptations in brackish water. Brackish water means it is an area where fresh water merges into the sea. What is brackish water? It is an area where fresh water merges into the sea. Now adaptations of the organisms in brackish water bodies. Now since there will be too many fluctuations in their salt concentrations, the organisms which are in brackish water should adapt wide range of fluctuations they should adapt wide range of fluctuations means a narrow range of salinity tolerating organisms are stenohaline. Wide range of salt tolerating ability organisms are called urehaline. Means the organisms which are in brackish water are urehaline then. So means they are urehaline. And if we have to discuss some examples here, so we can see that the fishes which are in marine water, marine fishes like salmon and hilsa, for laying the eggs, they move from seawater to fresh water for the purpose of laying eggs. Now this migration of movement of the fish from seawater to freshwater is called as anadromous migration. So salmon and hilsa, they show anadromous migration. Now when from marine water, if it is going to fresh water, then what happens? Outside the salt concentration is more, inside the right, they're going from marine water to fresh water, then in its body salt concentration will be more, outside it is fresh water, right? So to maintain it, Salmon and Hilsa, as soon as they go into the fresh water, they start drinking more water. They start drinking more water to reduce their salt concentration inside the body. And the kidneys, what they are having, the kidneys which they have are adapted to control the water concentration, are adapted to control the salt concentration also. The kidneys and the salt glands, or the chloride cells, we can tell. The kidneys and the chloride cells can tackle the problem of excess salt and less salt, or excess water and less water, right? So this is one migration which is called anadromous migration. If you take another fish like anguilla, now this fish, it moves from fresh water to marine water, again for the same purpose of laying eggs. Marine water to fresh water, if it is called anadromous migration, fresh water to marine water is called catadromous migration. It is called catadromous migration. And again, the fish, when it is moving from fresh water to marine water, for such type of fishes, what the kidneys are there, the chloride cells are there, so they can tackle the water related issues. So what we discussed is the adaptations, water related adaptations in fresh water conditions, in marine water conditions, in brackish water conditions. Okay, and in the NCERT exercises, in this chapter 10th question, they asked you to differentiate between camouflage and mimicry. They asked you to differentiate between dormancy and hibernation. That also we will see in today's session itself. So far what we have discussed is water related adaptations of fresh water, brackish water and marine water. Now our next topic is NCERT exercise question number 10. They have asked, differentiate between, so they have asked camouflage and mimicry. Let us do this concept also in the today's class. Now, what is camouflage means? It is the resemblance of an organism with the surrounding atmosphere so that it is not identified by the predator, right? So then what is mimicry? Mimicry is one organism mimicking like another organism. For example, if any student in the class, if they try to imitate me, so then that is mimicry. So but then camouflage, what is it? It's a resemblance of an animal with the surroundings so that it can hide from the predator. That's the first difference. Let us write down what's the first difference. Camouflage means it is the resemblance of organism with the, I told it is with the surrounding environment. Whereas in mimicry, I told it is the resemblance of an animal with another animal. One student is mimicking like me. So it is the resemblance of an animal with the other animal that I am writing here. So mimicry means it is the resemblance of one animal like another animal. Now, the organism, okay, which is mimicking, the organism which it is imitating is called model. Now, if a student is imitating me, so I am model here. And a student who is doing my mimicry is mimic. So, organism which is imitating, which organism you are imitating is a model, right? And the organism who is mimicking is called mimic. That is called mimic. Understood? Now, in camouflage, it is making, blending with the nature so that it will be unnoticed by the predator. So, it remains unnoticed from very distance. Very near you come and very keenly you observe, you can find it. Means it remains unnoticed from a distance. In camouflage, we can write, it remains unnoticed from distance. But here, in mimicry, the mimic is noticed. From distance also it is noticed, or from nearby also it is noticed. But then you cannot differentiate whether it is a mimic or modeler, because mimic is mimicking like a model. So we can tell, in mimicry, they are noticed. It's not like unnoticed. So, the mimic is noticed from a far distance also. It is noticed. We are telling from distance it is not noticed, but this is noticed. Now, camouflage, why it is doing? To escape from the predator. So, it is beneficial for all the types of animals. Doing camouflage is beneficial to all types of animals. But here, it will be beneficial only to the mimic, right? So, it will be beneficial only to mimic. Then, next one, doing camouflage is a general phenomenon, but doing mimicry is a special phenomenon. So, this is a general adaptation, whereas this is a special adaptation. If I have to quote down the examples for camouflage, grasshopper, you know, it will blend in the grass, it will blend in the leaves, and praying mantis also, it will blend in the foliage. So then stick insects, whether you have seen or not, it will be like stick only, but inside that insect will be there. So it will blend with the surroundings. Leaf insect also will be there. It will exactly look like a leaf from distance. You can't notice it that it's an insect. So the examples for camouflage, what we can write? So we can write grasshopper, praying mantis, and I told stick insect, and I told leaf insect. These are the examples for camouflage. And if we have to write the examples for mimicry, first we will see there are two types of mimicries. One is Batesian mimicry, other one is Mullerian mimicry. So that we will write down. There are two types of mimicries. One is, and other one is Mullerian mimicry. Now, what is Batesian mimicry? What is Mullerian mimicry? In Batesian mimicry, the mimic is defenseless. The mimic is defenseless, but you know, it is somehow forecasting, it is somehow behaving like it is a dangerous one. Means, which model it is mimicking? It's mimicking a dangerous model. So, predator will think, okay, this is the model itself, and it will go away. So, in Batesian mimicry, we can tell that the mimic is defenseless and it resembles the dangerous or unpalatable model. What is Batesian mimicry here? So, the mimic is a defenseless organism, but it mimics like a model which is dangerous, right? It's imitating a dangerous creature, so predator will think it's a dangerous creature and it will run off. So it imitates a dangerous creature or an unpalatable model. So example for Batesian mimicry, if you want, Viceroy butterfly will mimic like a monarch butterfly. Viceroy butterfly will mimic like a monarch butterfly. What is this? Monarch butterfly, in its cocoon stage, in the larval stage, it has feed on a poisonous glycoside. and it will not be tasteful. It's distasteful. So predators don't want to eat monarch butterfly. Now this viscerae butterfly, it wants to protect itself. So it is mimicking like a monarch butterfly. Then the predator, when it comes, it thinks it's not a viscerae butterfly, it's a monarch butterfly, which is distasteful. It will not eat it. This is about bats in mimicry. In Mullerian mimicry, we can tell it is a resemblance of two animals, not one animal. It is a resemblance of two animals because of their mutual benefits. So in Mullerian mimicry, it is the mimicry among two organisms. It's a mimicry among two organisms because of their mutual benefits. Because of their mutual benefits, they will mimic each other. Now, example for Mullerian mimicry, we can take monarch butterfly and queen butterfly. They will mimic like each other. So, we can write the same monarch butterfly. It is M-O-N-A-R-C-H. Monarch butterfly and the queen butterfly. Right? So, this is our topic. We were discussing question number 10 in Organisms and Population chapter. The question says, differentiate between camouflage and mimicry. Amma, this is also adaptation only. What is camouflage? The organism or the insect or the creature, it will blend with the surroundings so that it remains unnoticed by the predator so that it can save its life. That's what I wrote. It is a resemblance of the organism with the surrounding environment. Whereas here, it is a resemblance of one animal like another animal. So best example what I told is, if you people are imitating me, so then the organism, if you are imitating me, so I am the model and the student who is imitating me will be the mimic here. Now, it remains unnoticed from distance. Only when you keenly observe, you can differentiate it. But here, it is doing the mimicry, it is noticed from short distance also, from long distance also, it is noticed. And here, it is beneficial for all organisms. But here, only the mimic gets benefited here. And it's a general adaptation, that's a special adaptation. And if you have to see the examples, grasshopper. So, grasshopper, praying mantle, it resembles the foliage, the leaves. Stick insect resembles the surrounding sticks. Leaf insect resembles the leaf. That's it. Now, coming to mimicry, there are two types of mimicries. Batsian mimicry, Mullerian mimicry. In Batsian mimicry, we tell that the mimic is a defenseless creature. If it is defenseless, the predator comes and eats on it. So, that is why, cleverly what it is doing? So, it is telling like, I'm a dangerous creature. It's mimicking the model which is dangerous or distasteful. Right? People don't like to eat bitter gourd because it is distasteful. So, then it will be avoided. Example, viscerae butterfly doing the mimicry of like a monarch butterfly. Mullerian mimicry, two organisms, they exchange with each other. Example, monarch butterfly and queen butterfly. So, the last topic in the same question is, they're asking us to differentiate between diapause and hibernation. That also we will see and we'll end our session today. So, the 10th question, one more difference is there. They're asking us to differentiate between hibernation and diapause. We'll see that also. Hope you are enjoying the classes, you are understanding. So, any comments, please you can comment in the comment box so that, like, if I understand, we can make it in a better way. Okay. The next question is, differentiate between diapause and hibernation is one question we have. Let us see a few differences between diapause and hibernation. We studied this. Some are regulators, some are confirmers, some are suspenders, some are migrators. Under suspenders, we discussed about diapause, the zooplanktons. So, in unfavorable conditions, so they go to a stage of suspended development. Means, what is diapause? It's a dormant stage. It's a dormant stage in the development of an organism. The organism is not still completely developed. It has gone to an inactive stage or dormant stage. So, what can we write here? It's a dormant stage in the development of an organism. So, what is it, ma? It is a dormant stage in the development of an organism. Whereas if we have to tell what is hibernation, hibernation, it is the stage of inactivity in not a developing organism, in a matured organism. Hibernation, it is a state of inactivity. It's a state of inactivity in a mature organism itself, not a developing organism. This is one difference. And if we have to discuss, hibernation is called winter sleep. But diapause, unfavorable condition, it can be summer also, it can be winter also. So diapause can be seen in summer also and winter also. Whereas hibernation is winter sleep only, means seen in winter season only. Am I correct? Now next one. In this dormant stage, in the developing organism, the water content gets reduced and no such water reduction in the hibernation state. So the water content gets reduced, whereas no water reduction, no water content reduction. And if we have to list down the examples for diapause, we have studied that zooplanktons will exhibit diapause. Let us write down the examples also. Zooplanktons exhibit diapause. And hibernation, we know polar bears to avoid severe winter because they are poikilothermic, right? They are ectothermals. And frog and amphibians also will go for hibernation. Yeah, let us write down. So polar bear is one example. The frogs and other amphibians are the examples. That's it. So what did we discuss, children, in today's session? We discussed about water related adaptations, freshwater adaptations, marine water adaptations, brackish water adaptations. Then we came and we discussed the differences, 10th question in NCERT exercises, differences between camouflage and mimicry, differences between diapause and hibernation. So if there are any queries related to the lectures, so kindly post it in the comment box. If you like my content, you can like, share and subscribe to my channel. Thank you.